Time to tell tales of the unaccountable, of apparitions by night and phantoms in shadow. Time to tell strange stories of fantasy and the supernatural. Mystery Theater presents The Screaming Skull, a tale of the supernatural by George Salverson, based on a story by Marion Crawford, and starring Tommy Tweed as the captain and Hugh Webster as James.
This is the house, Captain?
It is, James.
Nice place for an old sea dog to retire to.
It's a pretty little property, just the thing for an old sailor like me who's taken to gardening.
You won't be gardening in this weather.
That's true, James. Let's get in out of the wet.
Listen to the wind and the sea. You must feel right at home here.
At home? Come in. Come in, James. Close the door.
Right.
Sit there by the fire. I'll put something in a glass to warm you.
Wonderful. Ah, it's a night for a burning log on the hearth.
And for Holland gin. This is the same I brought Luke from Amsterdam 25 years ago. He never touched a drop of it.
Luke was your cousin, Captain Braddock, wasn't he?
He was. That's how I came by this house. After he died and his boy Charlie was killed in South Africa, there were no relations left. Here now, see if this doesn't warm your blood, James.
Thank you. Wasn't there a Mrs. Pratt?
Yes, there was.
What happened to her?
Well, she died before Luke.
Oof! Strong stuff, Captain. Listen. You can hear the tide.
Gloomy sound, isn't it?
Yes. Do you remember the German ship we sailed on? Listen. Did you hear that, Captain?
Yes.
Someone screamed. It must be from the beach.
No, it isn't from the beach.
Oh, someone may be in trouble. We'd best have a look.
Sit down, James. No one's in trouble.
Well, why do you say that? You said you heard it, too?
What's interesting is that you heard it, James.
What do you mean by that?
There are always people who think it's the wind or my imagination.
Then what was it?
Put another stick on the fire, will you?
Yes.
It's only something to do with the wind and the tide. Yeah, this is good enough for old sailors like us, James. I don't think Mary Pratt was very happy here.
Might be a little gloomy for a woman at that.
Poor woman. I suppose in a way I was responsible for her death.
What's that, Captain?
It was on a night like this. I was at home for a spell, waiting to take the Olympia out on her first trip.
That voyage when she broke the record?
No, that was the next one. Oh. But that dates it.
1892?
In November. In this very room it was. Oh, the weather was dirty. Pratt was in his usual bad temper, and poor Mary Pratt's dinner was a failure.
You see that, Captain? My wife is trying to poison me.
Luke, he's joking, Mary.
Oh, I wish he were joking.
Welsh rarebit, raw turnips, and half-boiled mutton. Charles, if you ever marry, don't marry a fool.
You see what he thinks of me? You see how he goes on?
On second thought, perhaps it's better to marry a woman foolish enough to poison you with Welsh rarebit instead of spun glass or chopped horsehair.
Oh, you see, Luke's only joking. After all, he's a doctor. He knows all the antidotes, eh, Luke?
Not for some things.
Oh, of course, there was that woman in Ireland, the one who did for three husbands before anyone suspected a thing. Be glad you aren't married to one like that, Luke.
How did she manage it?
Well, her fourth husband managed to keep awake after she drugged him and
caught her at it.
Caught her at what?
Well, she had a little horn funnel, and she put it into his ear.
This sounds rather ridiculous, old man.
Well, that's what he thought, until he saw her coming with the ladle filled with melted lead.
That's rather funny. Yeah.
Oh, that's terrible. Charles, that's awful. Oh, don't you dare tell such a story here ever again.
In this very room it was. James, if I were you, I would never tell ugly stories about ingenious ways of killing people. Listen.
What? You heard that sound again, Captain?
No, that was the wind backing up to the southern again. I can tell by the sound.
Are you trying to tell me that Mrs. Pratt killed her husband?
No, she couldn't have. You see, she died that same November.
Good heavens, man.
Yes, Luke was a lonely man after that.
Lonely?
Oh, I could see it. I came to see him now and then.
And he looked lonely?
Oh, yes. Very worn and nervous. That last time I saw him, there was the thing about the dog.
Thing about a dog?
Yes. Luke was so thin, his head looked like a skull with parchment stretched over it. And his eyes had a sort of glare. He glared at me when I asked about the dog.
I killed the dog.
That sweet-tempered old bulldog.
I could stand it no longer, Charles.
But the dog was ill?
No. But he used to climb into that chair where you're sitting now.
Yes?
That was my wife's chair, you know.
Well, I know, Luke, but after all...
You never saw him do it. Old Bumble used to sit there and stare at me. We'd stare at each other, thinking over old times. And then the fool dog would begin to shake all over and set up a howl as if he'd been shot, and then he'd run and hide under the sideboard, making the strangest noises.
Why, poor old Bumble.
I couldn't stand it. He didn't suffer at all, Charles. I put dionine into his drink to make him sleep soundly, and then I chloroformed him gradually so that he couldn't have suffered even in a dream. He didn't suffer.
Well, I believe you, Luke.
He didn't suffer a bit. And it's been quieter since then.
He said, it's been quieter since then. Now I know what he meant. He meant that he didn't hear that noise so often. Perhaps he thought at first that it was old Bumble in the yard howling at the moon. Perhaps that's what he thought.
Good heavens!
It's not that kind of noise at all, is it, James?
That sound. What is it, Captain?
Don't be frightened, man. It won't eat you. It's only a noise. And a noise never hurt anyone.
That's all very well, but what is it?
When I don't understand a thing, I call it a phenomenon. And I don't take it for granted that it's going to kill me. Besides, what is there to prove Luke killed his wife?
Is there a connection?
Did I say there was?
Well, you were. What did they say she died of?
She died in bed a few days after I told that story.
But of what?
A heart trouble.
But you don't believe that?
Why not? Luke called in another doctor and he believed it.
But you don't.
Of course I believe it.
Only
pour yourself another drop and I'll show you something.
I think I will.
I keep it locked in this old roller-top desk of Luke's. That's where I found it, you know. Ah, here we are.
You mean that pistol?
No, no, no. That's the old pistol I bought in Rio for a souvenir when you and I went ashore. Remember the Leofric, James?
Mm-hmm.
Grand vessel. Sailed. Those were the days, James.
What were you going to show me?
I imagine Luke was fond of deep-sea fishing. Probably used this for casting a sinker for a nightline. Do you think, James?
An iron ladle?
You can see there it was hardened in the bottom of the bowl. The melted lead.
Why, James, you dropped your drink. I'll get you another.
You won't mention this, will you? After all, Luke's dead now, with an honest man's tombstone at his head.
There was trouble enough about his death as it was. No reason for James Treherne to hear about a thing like this ladle. Here you are.
Thanks. James Treherne?
He's the sexton, and he works in my garden.
Works in your garden?
Oh, I didn't tell you about that. It was when I retired, and having inherited the property from poor old Luke, I moved in. This James Treherne showed me through the house and told me the story and showed me the thing in the cupboard.
That curious thing to keep in the cupboard? I mean, when you consider this here's the bedroom.
This hat box?
Same as they found by old Luke down on the beach.
When he died?
That's right. You remember the verdict? By the hands or teeth of some person or animal unknown.
I know. I heard all about that. Some big dog chewed him to death.
That don't horrify you, Captain.
Oh, I suppose. I've seen a good deal around this world, however.
Have you ever seen a bit of interior decoration like this?
What is it?
Hat box. Open it up, Captain.
You're very mysterious, Treherne. All right, I'll open it up.
Very pretty and polished. And white, ain't it, Captain?
A skull.
It's what it is, all right. Found by him when he was dead there on the beach.
Oh, what of it? Luke was a doctor. It's not unusual for a doctor to have a thing like this.
But it is unusual for a thing like this to roll. When he fell dead, mind you, not down the slope of the beach towards his feet, but up the slope of the beach toward his head.
Oh, you what?
It rolled up the beach.
Oh.
From where the open hat box was found.
Phenomenon.
This here phenomenon lay right up against his poor throat, all broken and bruised by, like you say, Captain, some big dog. Do you notice something else?
No.
Here, take it.
Well?
Give it a shake.
What?
Go on, shake it.
All right.
Now, ain't that a peculiar sound?
There's something inside.
Pretty small, very nice shape to it. Perfect teeth.
Well, it's only a medical specimen.
I wonder where the lower jaw got to. With them teeth, she would have had a pretty smile. Wouldn't she, Captain?
That's what he said. After that, I got something into my head. Oh, I don't mean anything supernatural. As far as that goes, I'd rather face any shape of ghost than a fog in the channel when it's crowded, eh, James?
Oh, what was it you got into your head?
No, there's no sense to it.
Didn't she have a Christian burial?
Well, certainly. She's lying in the churchyard where Treherne put her to rest.
It's monstrous.
To suppose her husband kept her skull in her old hat box in the bedroom.
It's ridiculous. Captain, you play me for a fool. Pour me another drink.
Yes, it's ridiculous.
I suppose he had done. I mean, the ladle and the melted lead and all that. But then...
Why did he do this other thing?
Yes. Why?
He could have been afraid of something else that I told him when I told that story.
What?
Well, the woman that did for those three husbands, they dug up the three skulls, you know.
And?
And in each, there was a small lump of lead rattling around. That's what hanged her. I suppose he'd remember that was the vital evidence.
Captain Charlie Braddock.
James?
You old fraud, you sea dog, you pirate, you old devil.
What, James?
Get me another drink, you dog.
Yeah, but what is so funny?
you invite me here to this haunted-looking cottage of yours by the gloomy sea, and you set me down by your fireplace and spin me a yarn like... You old lying fraud of a sailor.
Lord.
He'd remember that was the vital evidence. I've often wondered how he managed it. What do you suppose he put in its place?
Do you mean that sound came from your bedroom?
James, let me tell you about the night I tried to get rid of the thing. It's not happy anywhere else, you know. It wants to be in Mary Pratt's hat box in that cupboard. At least I think it does. I sleep in Luke's old surgery now, you know. But then when I first came, I slept in the bedroom. Well, I slept well. You know, an old sailor, no natural sound disturbs you. Not all the racket of a square rigger hove to in a heavy gale. But any unnatural sound, and you wake in a moment. That's how it was every night at exactly 3:17. I wonder if that was the hour she died. Then I would hear it and be exploded into a wakeful terror.
What? Not again? I won't have that again. I
won't stand this anymore. Now, I'm going to settle this. I'll take you and... Yes, the window. There. Here you go, hat box and all out the window. Oh, dear heaven, blot out my ears. Kill my hearing, deafen me, but never let me hear that again. Not stop screaming. Then when I thought I would go mad, it fell silent. I sat on my bed, listening, waiting. Hours passed. Then I heard a totally unexpected sound. Oh, someone at the door. Can't see the door from above, I called out. Who's there? Who is it? Who could it be, I thought. Oh, some old country fellow, stone deaf. I took my candle and went down to open the door. I set my candle down on the hall table. And then, when I opened the door, the wind blew it out. There was no one there. Shut the door. I lit the candle. There it was, at my feet, where the wind blew it in. The light and shadow from the candle playing in the hollows of it. So the eyes seemed to open and shut at me. We stared at each other.
I spoke to it. What do you want?
It wanted to go back to its cupboard. I knew that. But I stared at it, and I refused to move. I stared, and it stared back, and I waited.
I hurried outside. I found the hat box.
I ran inside, put the thing in the box, and returned it to its cupboard in the bedroom. After that, I slept in Luke's old surgery. But still, it screams at me. It hates me. I was the one who told Luke the story, you know. Listen, James.
What?
The wind and the tide.
Captain, do you have to go on with this story? Can't we talk about old times?
Yes, yes, old times. Yes. Remember old Blocklot?
A carpenter, wasn't he?
Yes. On the Clontarf.
I remember.
He used to say, when we were hove to in a howling gale...
I remember. Biddy de boor, pebble sore, tis night pies.
That's just the way he'd say it.
Yes, and always on a night like this.
Listen.
Huh. So that's what it is.
What, James?
You old fraud. That's the classic sound of wind howling in the chimney.
James, I'll get the thing and show it to you. Here's the box.
That's it?
Yes. My candle went out as I brought it downstairs.
Well, put the box down.
It went out, but that was the draft from the leaky window on the landing. Oh,
put it down.
Yes. Did you hear anything when I went up?
Yes.
There was another scream. Whatever that scream came from, it wasn't from this.
No?
I had the box in my hand when I heard the noise, and here it is now. So we have proved definitely that the screams are produced by something else.
The chimney.
To think I could have been so weak as to fancy that the poor skull could really cry out like a living thing with the agony of melted lead poured through the ear into its brain.
Then don't talk that way, Captain.
No, I won't.
Well, if you're going to show me Luke's medical specimen, open the box.
Yes, I will, James. You see how carefully I wrapped it in brown butcher's paper and tied it with string. Mm-hmm. Now, we look at it under the bright lamp. It's awful to think that the poor lady used to sit there in your chair where the dog Bumble later stared at Luke in just the same lamplight.
Oh, come now, Captain. Let's have a look at this.
See? Here's the label I put on it to seal the string. And here's what I wrote.
Once the property of the late Luke Pratt, M.D., one skull. Well, open it, Captain.
I often wondered what sort of hat it was that came in this box.
What kind of hat?
A gay spring hat with a bobbing feather and pretty ribbons. Strange if this same box should hold the head that wore
open
that...
Open it.
Yes. Open it. No. Strange. I don't have the strength in my hands anymore, James. Can you break the string?
Yes. There.
Now. Oh, good Lord, take the lamp.
The window.
James, the lamp.
Close that window, Captain.
Yes, I'll close the window, but don't let the lamp go out if you can help it.
How can I help it if you don't close the blasted window? Now, shut out that gale.
Yes, dear. Here. The bolt was only half down. It won't blow open again. That's the advantage of these old-fashioned windows with the bolt. Now, the hat box.
Where is it?
Where? Did it blow off the table?
Oh, must be here.
Ah, there it is, on the floor. Hand it up there, will you, James?
There you are. Now, open it.
There. You see? The lid comes off easily enough. There. Now, look, James.
At what? There's nothing in the box.
What? Empty?
Empty, Captain.
No, that must not be.
Captain, there never was a skull, was there?
Never a skull?
No skull. You imagined the whole thing.
Yes. Yes, I imagined it. Turn up the lamp.
Yes. You've been living alone too long, old friend.
I can't understand. Do you suppose the sextant Traherne suspects something? Do you suppose he could have stolen it?
Why would he steal it?
What's that? On the floor.
Where?
There, by your foot.
No, Captain, for heaven's sake, it's nothing.
Nothing at all, but...
But this...
But what?
This.
Then I'm guilty. Then Luke did listen to the story. Then the thing does hate me. And this fell out just now when the box blew to the floor. It hates me.
Why would it hate you?
Because I told the story. And there you have the end of the story. A round ball of lead.
Then, where's the skull? Do you want me to answer?
No.
No, I'm not going to answer it, Captain.
It hates me. I told Luke the story. How did it get out of the box this time?
This is no affair. Captain, I'm going. Are you coming?
Where?
Out the other way, the back way.
No, it hates me. It blames me.
Then I'm going. You can come or not.
No, it hates me.
Come with me, Captain. Leave this and come with me.
No.
Then God help you. Because I can't.
James. James! What do you want of me? Don't do that. Don't. I know the frightful agony, the hot lead, the melted metal searing into the brain. Don't blame me. I know what you want. Here it is. My pistol. The old pistol from Rio. You remember, James? No, I won't answer. Don't blame me. Don't blame me. I won't open the door. I knew what you wanted.
Mystery Theater has presented The Screaming Skull, a tale of the supernatural by Marion Crawford, adapted for radio by George Salverson. With Hugh Webster as James, Tommy Tweed as the Captain, Drew Thompson as Luke, Marion Waldman as Mary, his wife, and Eric Clavering as Traherne. Sound effects were by John Sliz, and technical operation by Robert Burt. This is Bill Lorne speaking.